Joining us now is Peter Rojas, partner at BetaWorks Ventures and former Engadget editor. Peter, good to see you.
Hi, thanks for having me on.
So do you think this is going to stick this time? I mean, just a week or two ago, we were talking about Facebook and people criticizing them and people, you know, boycotting Facebook. We don't seem to be talking about that much anymore. Now it's Apple. Is this just another blip, or are they in serious trouble here?
Well, I would say that Epic was ready for this. You don't pull a move like this and have, you know, a PR campaign ready to go, a lawsuit waiting in the wings, unless you are prepared for a battle. And I think the thing that is dangerous for Apple here is that Tim Sweeney, the CEO of Epic and the maker of Fortnite, is, you know, he isn't just motivated by gaining market share or by making more money here. I think that he actually does have an ideological component to this, that he does believe that monopolistic control of platforms is bad and that it is something that he wants to break up and take on. And so, you know, Epic is in this unique position where they are big enough to matter, but they are not dependent on Apple and Google, you know, for their business. Only about 20% of Fortnite players are on mobile or primarily on mobile. Mm-hmm. And so Epic has a big business outside of this, not just with Fortnite, but with Unreal Engine and other games. And so they have the resources to make this, you know, to take this battle to Apple. And I think that is something that's very dangerous for them.
Yeah, not only that, to paraphrase Hamilton, Tim Sweeney is a host unto himself, right? He's that unique type of developer that not only has a track record and commands respect, but he's got this diversified group of platforms that he plays in. Fortnite has its own economic ecosystem. The real danger here is that he feeds the antitrust story against Apple and against Google, right? So do you think investors should be watching the services margins here and perhaps attaching a different kind of risk premium to the possibility of growth there?
Well, I think for Apple, I mean, the percentage of their overall revenue, which they derive from the App Store, is relatively small. So they can afford to give here, and it's not going to, you know, make that much of a difference for the company. But the reality is that the rules that they set down for the App Store 10 years ago or so were for a different internet, right? I mean, you didn't have as many cross-platform games and applications as we do now. You didn't have as much of the cloud-based services and applications as we do now. And I think that the reality is that a lot of these rules, you know, they make less sense or less coherent today than they, you know, would have been at the beginning, you know, 10 years ago when they introduced the App Store. And so I think, you know, when Facebook and now Airbnb, they introduced these online events, these virtual events, the idea that Apple should take 30% of that rather than 30% going to the people who are actually hosting and creating the events is something that I think strikes people as a little bit unfair. And I think for Epic, ultimately, you know, they're interested in fostering a very vibrant and successful game ecosystem, not just for Fortnite, but for any game that's using Unreal Engine, which is a huge part of their business. And so the more game developers who can build a sustainable business selling games is good for Epic. And Unreal Engine. And so 30% is a big tax to pay, as opposed to the 12% which Epic takes from its own game store.
So as you know, Peter, it's not just Epic that has gone after Apple for this very issue. Spotify was one of the early ones. In fact, they're leading the complaint to the EU, whose antitrust regulators are looking into this very issue. Just a few weeks ago, during that tech hearing where Tim Cook was on Capitol Hill, we talked to the CFO of Spotify about this issue. Here's what he said about Apple.
As a platform, they're also a gatekeeper. And for us, it's really about not having programs in place that disadvantage competition or things that put restrictions on competitors. And so the 30% fee for in the app is obviously restrictive. Our ability to properly message and communicate with our users also is restrictive. And so for us, we're just looking for a level playing field so that our streaming service is competitive with what they offer. Look, I think our growth has been phenomenal, and I think we've done exceptionally well in spite of some of the restrictions that Apple has put in front of us. So, you know, the question is, how much better would we have done had we not had some of the restrictions placed against us?
So, Peter, it's a little bit of a pile-on here against Apple. You are an investor in early startups. What's your point of view? Do you think that they're anti-competitive, or are you happy to get your startups on the App Store because of the technology and opportunity and access that it affords?
Well, it's a double-edged sword, right? And I think one of the challenges is that it's a lot harder to grow an app now than it used to be. In the early days of the App Store, sometimes just being in there was enough to drive downloads and get people to discover it. Now there are millions and millions of apps all competing for attention, and it's very difficult to grow your user base without paying for acquisition. And sometimes you're paying Apple to show up in search ads against your own, you know, name for your ad, so that somebody, some competitor, can't put themselves ahead of you in the search. And so, you know, for a lot of startups, a 30% of revenue going out the door is really tough when you're spending money to get those customers in the first place. And so, you know, I think that nobody disagrees that Apple shouldn't take some amount of money. Certainly, providing the store is a valuable service, you know, you can build a real business, obviously, on top of you know, these mobile app stores. But the 30% is striking people as, if not unfair, then at least untenable in a lot of ways. And, you know, just to give an example of TikTok, TikTok spent billions of dollars on user acquisition. They didn't grow just via viral word of mouth. You know, those days are largely behind us. And so, you know, for startups starting out, unless you have a huge budget out the gate, it can be very, very difficult to grow those businesses.